welcome back.
Hey, Stanley.
Yeah, George?
How would you like your own TV show?
Hey, I got something to mail you out.
Oh, you be careful now, you hear? Before you go and say something you're going to regret for the rest of your days.
Like what? Like the wrong kid, Dad?
Oh, no!
Hey, everybody, welcome to this episode of The Wrong Podcast Died. I'm Brian.
I'm Rod.
And today we have a special guest. We're going back to December 6th, 1990. And what did we say? The moon is in the waning Gibbons phase. It's day 18.26 of the moon. That's how old it is. And it's 82.13% illuminated.
Ooh.
It's kind of like the opposite of what it is right now.
Is it? So we have our... our moon specialist,
lunar specialist,
Autumn. She's named after one of the seasons, even
right now.
Hey, it's my favorite season.
It's the only time I come out, actually.
You only get her on this episode as a guest because it's Autumn.
Yeah,
and we're talking about one of her favorite movies.
Yeah, I think it embodies like my vibe.
Edward Scissorhands is her vibe. Weird.
It's gorgeous. It's weird. Well, I'm not saying I'm gorgeous. It's things that I love. Aesthetically, it is literally perfect for me, in my eyes.
So a 1990 American Gothic romantic fantasy film.
Avon calling!
Ooh, this is some huge house, isn't it? Hello?
Why are you hiding back there? You don't have to hide from me. I'm as harmless as cherry pump. Those are your hands. Those are your hands.
Directed by Tim Burton. It's produced by Tim Burton and Denise Devonia. Written by Carolyn Thompson from a story by her and Burton. Did you know that?
I did not know that. I didn't get into that too much.
Who's in it, Autumn? Anybody you know?
Nona. She's like at her peak in this. A really gorgeous, fun, great actress. And Johnny.
Johnny Depp.
What were the parents? I loved the mom.
Diane Weiss.
Weiss.
Alan Arkin. Is he the dad? Kathy Baker. Anthony Michael Hall. Who's the most important person in this movie, though, Rod?
Vincent Price as the inventor.
Vincent Price. Yeah, he creates Edward Scissorhands because he's a cookie maker.
Will you guys tell me more about that? I'm never gonna understand it. Yeah.
The Vincent Price, or
yeah, just all about that whole the lore, everything behind his life.
I gather he just wanted somebody to keep company, kind of like, you know, Geppetto made Pinocchio.
He kind of looks at all of his machines at one point and just they're just too animated. They're doing the same thing over and over. And then he looks at the one and he thinks, I think that's where he gets the ideal to create his own person. Of course, as you see in the movie, he gives him scissor hands for some reason or another. I don't know why, but.
So did he want him to be a machine, you think, a bit? Like an ex machina?
No, because I think it seems like towards the end, you know, he had the hands ready for him. And that's where, you know, he passes away. I think he was trying to make him a human, like completely human. It just took him some time.
So yeah, later on in the movie, we'll find out that Vincent Price, who is Edward Scissorhands' father, parent for lack of a better term, has made hands for him and is going to put him on, but he has a heart attack and he dies. I didn't even remember that part of the movie.
Yeah.
I think it's like towards the end is when you see it.
Late in the third act that we find that out.
That was the last cinematic performance of Vincent Price. And then the irony is that it was a death scene.
Yeah. Wow, really?
Yeah.
And,
so early on in the movie, we have Edward, we have the Avon ladies going around. When they had Avon people go around the houses, she finds Edward alone. He's scared. She brings him home. And then, you know, of course, all the women in the town or in the area start calling each other. Who's going there? I don't even remember the lady's name, Bonnie, or you probably know the name, Rod, but they start calling each other and they're like, oh my God, who is that? Who is that?
It's like they got a hotline.
We just go on this little adventure with Edward where he becomes the hairstylist and the person that trims their bushes. And he becomes a dog groomer. And then he becomes a robber. And he just goes on this.
But then he becomes human.
Yeah. I think he's always... Is he a robot? We never really find that out what he was.
Yeah. Kind of like,
but is he? Is he a robot on the inside or some kind of machine?
But what is consciousness? You really want to have that conversation right now?
No. I only have till... it's a school night, kids. We got to get home at some point.
Yeah, he's human. He's sweet. He's a sweetie.
I think anything that can feel emotion is human or has a soul.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, outside of the family, a lot of people take advantage of him or try to take advantage of him. Like you said, Autumn, it's a beautiful film. It looks amazing.
From the beginning.
Yeah, it's classic Tim Burton.
This is like almost the beginning of Tim Burton, besides Pee-wee's, Pee-wee's Big Adventure was one of his big films. But this is his first with Johnny Depp, and he would go on to collaborate another 7 times, so 8 movies altogether with Johnny.
Critical success, commercial success. I mean, grossed $80 million. I think it cost like 19 or 20.
Yeah, $20 million budget.
Won a British Academy Award for Best Production and Design, a Hugo Award for Best Dramatic Presentation, bunch of nominations from the Academy Awards, the Saturn Awards. Oh, and who did the soundtrack? Do you know who did the soundtrack?
Yes, I do. It's Danny Elfman, who would later on do a lot of soundtracks with Tim Burton.
I mean, Beetlejuice, the new Beetlejuice, and just...
Wow.
If you know who Danny Elfman is, and you start looking at his discography, you're like...
Just the most whimsical sounding music ever. Definitely a sound out of his own.
He kind of has like a punk rock look to him too, though, sometimes. You're like, you see him with his shirt off a lot, like on stage playing with his hair's crazy.
Tim Burton has claimed this to be his favorite, and so did, and Danny Elfman said it was his favorite soundtrack.
Oh, that's sweet.
December 6th in Los Angeles, December 7th throughout the world.
And then the 14th was like a wide release.
Wide release, okay. Just a great film. I mean, we could go into the film, but probably my favorite character, though, is the maid from 2.5 Men, and I can't remember the actress's name.
Yeah, Conchetta Farrell was the maid from 2.5 Men.
When I saw her, I was like, I freaking love her.
Aww.
And all the bit characters in this movie are great.
The one that was horny all the time.
Do you remember who the horny lady was? Is that Lon Jones?
I think that's Joyce, and it's Kathy Baker is her name.
I wanted to like her. I liked her style. I liked her nails. What do you guys think about her?
She's an odd one.
Well, you said you liked her style and her look, and yeah, she's odd. And she tries to take advantage of Edward at some point, so she's kind of...
She's very lonely.
I mean, we don't know how old he is. They kind of put him in as like a teenager, like he's going into high school, or maybe more because he's awkward socially and he's been so confined and alone for so long. As we're looking through the cast, one of the people that I find at the very bottom of the list, listed as a neighbor, is Nick Carter.
Oh, yeah, Nick Carter from Backstreet Boys, right?
Rock your body, yeah. Everybody, yeah. Rock your body right. Backstreet's back, alright.
Was he in the Backstreet Boys?
Wait, what?
Yeah,
why?
Nick Carter. I don't. He's a.
Yeah, he was a kid playing in the background.
I don't know. It'll
Aaron
probably show
is the
a
one
picture,
that passed
like,
away, and he, yep. I think, actually was. He was a Sagittarius, sweetie. He
It'll
was,
just show him
he
as his
like a sweet
current age.
Boy. Nick, I think, is a little dark.
Aaron passed away? Aaron Carter?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Where you been?
He was the youngest brother that kind of had a bigger kind of career for like a year or two.
Perfect,
yeah. Yeah.
And then he went through some rough times and, you know, did some strange things in the public. It was sad. I think he was always pretty sweet, though. That's so weird.
He's just a bit character in the background playing tiddlywinks or something, probably, you know, football or so. I don't even know, but yeah.
So you guys both have seen this movie quite a few times?
It's been a while for me. Yeah.
So what's something that stood out that was maybe different? Like, I always feel like I feel new things when I rewatch them now. Like, I have a different perspective on the movie a little bit.
As you age. And see, like, at the first watch, I was just like, oh, long time ago. Uh-huh. Just a fun, kind of whimsical movie. And this time, I watched and I'm like, God, all of these people outside, like, of the family, though, are trying to take advantage of him somehow. Like, uh-huh. The lady, you know, the kids that want him to rob the place, and even some of the neighbors were kind of rude to him and off-putting.
Well,
and then
the
there's
dads out there.
Yeah, like, the lady that was like, he's the devil. I don't even remember her from the original, like, watch. It's been a while. But I feel like maybe growing up in California when Tim Burton did, you would get all of that stuff when somebody moved in. And I almost wondered if it was like a commentary on when someone maybe of a different race moved in, or a different ethnicity, or maybe they didn't have the same lifestyle as the people that live there moved in.
Being othered in any way, basically, yeah. I think. Yeah, I feel that way. I felt like that almost was normal, something I remembered, and I think that is just like a hot topic now, and, you know, it's on my mind a lot. So I felt like my heart was warmed. You know, I shouldn't be surprised. I mean, it's still a movie, but like how sweet the parents were, and just kind of, they were just like, all right, you're here. You're a part of the family now, kind of.
Almost,
you know?
Like the movie Karina, you know, that movie with Ray Liotta and Whoopi Goldberg. Okay. Whoopi Goldberg is his nanny and his maid, and they end up falling in love. The mom, Karina's mom, had passed away, I think, but kind of like in that movie, how they were different because they were a biracial couple and people treated them different. But Ray Liotta was very open and accepting and realized that his daughter loved this person for who they were, not because of they didn't hold their color of their skin against them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and this family was open and accepting of Edward and more than happy to help him.
Yeah, and even now, movies can struggle to do this a bit because they want to make a statement.
Mm-hmm.
But I love how they did that so effortlessly.
Yeah.
It wasn't really like a subject. Yeah. It was just very much like, okay. And yeah. I like that. I like, there's people you know like that. And there's people who actively try to be good people. And I think that's wonderful too. But you can tell that I just like how many, you know, effortlessly.
Yeah, they did.
Especially the mother. I think she just had a very sweet, warm heart.
I took from it a little different. I mean, when I was a kid and saw it, it's probably the same. I thought it was a fun movie. You know, you see this guy making dinosaurs out of bushes and stuff. But this time, I think I felt a little more of a connection with Edward.
Yeah.
Because he was kind of admiring the daughter from afar. You know, he liked her just by looking at her picture. Like, that's where he first saw her. And then, you know, she shows up and then he sees her with the douche boyfriend and, you know, he's kind of sad, but he doesn't give up. And then when she starts showing him affection and everything, you know, he has limits. The hugging thing is a hard thing for him, things like that. I also kind of relate with Kim at the end because she looks back on all of this time when she's talking to her granddaughter and there's a lot of regret. There's like the things like she wished she would have done differently then. But, you know, she grew up and she's got a story to tell.
Since I was little, have been infuriated by those kind of stories and movies where they have so much regret. Because to me, I'm like, even if you're 90, go get your man. Don't you guys feel the same way to just kind of see them just, it's like you just go live your life then? Or what? I mean, that's like you said, he loved her from when he saw her. To me, as I've lived life, I relate to that even more in a way of, that's where you see, that's like a soul connection, you know? I mean, if we're really going to pick this apart, that's beautiful. Yes, he had a hard time. We know all the struggles. We've lived to them in some parallel way, you know? But you know what I mean? They
feel
that love, and then you're just like, oh, like, it was such a theme then, and I get it. It's nice and all, but the theme of, like, you'll be better off without me. It's like
you're missing a piece of yourself.
Yeah, I just don't. But I have always felt strange for being that way. And it's funny because, I don't know, maybe it's a past life thing, but I've always felt really infuriated by them kind of just.
The only thing I would say is, yeah, at some point, why did she go back and get Edward and take him somewhere where he could be safe? But again, at some point, she kind of explains it maybe in a way that before he came around, it never snowed.
Right.
So do I take him away from this world and take his beauty away from the world and take him somewhere else? But do you take the snow away? Like, she's come to say, I'm okay with the snow, and it brings joy to the children. It brings joy to the people. I'm okay with bringing joy to everybody and not keeping them to myself.
Go up there and make snow with your man. See, I get it.
Make him some damn hands.
Believe me. Like, I know.
Go up that hill, woman.
I know that this is, it's like a very common trope. I know I'm supposed to, if I was doing a TED talk on it, maybe I wouldn't bring it up. But I'm just, with you guys, I'm upset.
It's a very common theme in Edward Scissorhands in most mainstream movies, but on...
Like Titanic, yeah. Rose. She's like, I'll never let you go. And then she's like, see like, yo.
Oh, my finger slipped.
Yeah, like, I mean, it's to me, and I know it's psychotic, but if I were Rose, I'd probably just... I would go be with Jack at the bottom of the...
You need to watch Lifetime movies. The Lifetime movies, they always go back and get their man.
That's really sweet, and I love that for them, but I don't watch Lifetime.
They always get their... whoever they're after in those movies, they always go get.
They always get their man. Oh,
yeah,
like
or woman, or... Yeah, whatever. That's sweet. Yeah. But it's not realistic. I mean, Edward Scissorhands is probably more realistic than the Lifetime movies.
Honestly, we all can relate to anything at any time, you know? It's funny, though, because the time, if you notice, there's so many themes of unhappy wife, unhappy husband. It's like, that's what we do. We get married and we're miserable. And so even though the Edward, you know, plot was a lot more dramatic, it's kind of the same idea. If you really think about it, it's kind of like just getting used to being unhappy and just kind of accepting that, you know, am I projecting?
Maybe. Don't look at me. You on to like, me. She's like, so that's one of the main themes of the movie. But I feel like at the end, one of the main themes also is time has escaped her.
Oh,
right.
And it escapes everybody. At some point you look back and was like, I could have done that yesterday. I should have done that yesterday.
But I think overall, though, with her at the end of the movie, every time she sees the snow, she's comforted because she knows he's still up there and that he's still alive.
Well, that's so true. It's another beautiful thing about, especially if you lose someone truly to death or something that you've loved so much, that love still matters, you know? It still has changed you for the better and could be your greatest love, and it's still worth it. Even if it hurts you so badly, it's still worth it and beautiful. I love it.
So it's a love story. It's a story of regret and time lost. Not enough love, she says. I mean, Joyce was trying to get love, but he's got scissor hands. I mean, they make gloves for that kind of stuff now, don't they? Couldn't you put, like when you're
right through the gloves,
like a chef, you got to have them gloves that the knives won't cut through.
So
he could have put those on his hands, right?
Snipe sleeves.
Over his hands.
That's so crazy.
Yeah.
I feel like
I don't know. The pervert in me is always thinking of the parody movie.
Well, anybody can make it work. You know what I mean?
Edward Dill hands or whatever.
Yes. Love will. Yeah.
I've never seen that one, Rob. Did you know what he said? Edward Dildo Hands. It's a parody movie.
Okay. That's cute. That's so sweet.
I don't think it's cute.
No, I mean, I just think it's fun.
Because he's got five fingers on each hand, and there's not that many places to put them.
He's definitely, though, Edward Sagittarius hands.
Oh.
Because I told you guys, just like Ron, I think he's got that beautiful karmic lore behind him, as the kids say.
You're going to make me cry.
I will say, though, I feel like in my studies, a Sagittarius, they find, if they're lucky, if they stay alive long enough, if they do it, if they decide, they can find so much beauty from ruins, you know, whether their life becomes that or just a momentary, like, situation they're in, you know? I mean, he was probably miserable all the time. You can't feel good. You probably can't sleep well. You got scars all over your face. You got scissors for hands.
Where do you put those?
Your dad's so dumb that he made your hands scissors instead of like anything else.
Can't even put your hands in your pockets.
So it's like you love him, but you're, literally, like, he made so much beauty around him. I mean, he truly changed everybody's life. as much as I'm like, okay, I wish it was a little bit more romantic and a little sweeter, you know, it was so much about like familial love. And it's funny. I feel like a lot of Sagittarians have to find family outside of their blood sometimes.
One, at the end, you see him, his stuff that he's sculpting is all stuff from when he was with the family.
So cool, yeah.
Yeah, so he's got memories. The only memories he really has is from the time with them. So if Rod is Edward Scissorhands mm-hmm. as a character, what are you? A movie character.
My moon is an Edward.
As a movie character.
What am I? So I...
You could be from any movie.
Oh my gosh.
What character? Like
that's a tough question.
Well, yeah. What are you?
Well, I don't know. You're the expert.
Well, you... Okay.
That's why we brought you on the show.
I could tell you what you are.
Okay. See, that was easy.
Let's stay around with these movies. Okay. Like, I feel like Beetlejuice goes hand in hand.
Edward Scissorhands. Yeah.
Okay, so Beetlejuice, I feel like it's funny because a Sagittarius could decide to be a Beetlejuice. They're very different. That's kind of like what stands out to me.
So you think Beetlejuice is an Aries?
Maybe.
So Tim Burton movies are Edward Scissorhands. You're
probably right. The boyfriend's probably an Aries, honestly. Yeah. I'm so sorry.
Sweeney Todd, Frankenweenie, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, Ed Wood, a couple Batman movies. Mars Attacks, Beetlejuice, The Corpse Bride.
Well, I've been told I'm definitely the witch in a lot of like stuff. I'm the Blair.
The Blair Witch.
Ooh, like Sleepy Hollow.
Yes. Yeah, that's a Tim Burton movie, Sleepy Hollow. Yeah.
Well, no, I'm not like, you know, I'm definitely.
But the Blair Witch was a bad witch. I don't feel like you're a bad witch, and you don't really see the Blair Witch. So.
Well, you don't really see me. Do you see me right now, Rod? Tell me.
I see your shoulder.
Oh, yeah, okay. Well,
yeah. That is one fine looking shoulder.
Thank you so much, honestly.
What about my shoulder, Rod?
I have to look at your shoulders all the time.
Okay. Yeah, you're right. And they're not. But, you know, I think I was the neighborhood in this movie.
In this movie? Okay.
That beautiful, beautiful. They were almost like neon pastels. You know what I mean?
Yep. Yeah.
I will say, I feel like the dialogue was a little bit underwhelming.
Yeah. You don't go to a Tim Burton movie for the dialogue, though.
Well, I mean, it's interesting. Like, if it did have, there were so many moments that I felt like, it's hard not to compare Winona to, like, other movies. So, you guys know Heathers?
Yep.
It's a nice, spooky one. You like Heathers?
Yeah.
We're well-versed in Heathers.
You are?
Yeah. Okay. Heathers is great.
Heathers is a great movie. So, think about, like, all the weird jabs and just the weird verbiage. If you added that to, like, a movie like Edward Scissorhands, oh my god, that would be my favorite movie of all time. I mean, I couldn't. But it's just, this is one that just feels comfortable. It looks beautiful. It's just very, like, it gets you in the mood for spooky season. He has a way, especially in this movie, because I feel like the visuals are so important, showing people who maybe they don't have an artistic mind. That's not their whole thing. Showing them, like, what we see. Because truly, I feel like that's what I see when I look at things. If that makes sense, you know?
Did we figure out what character Brian is?
She went to the movie Beetlejuice, but she never got any further than that. Beetlejuice?
The sandworm?
I don't know. What do you feel? I said, unfortunately, I do feel like maybe the boyfriend is an Aries, okay?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, that's
I think
fine.
Edward is, he's probably the reverse of me. He's probably a Sagittarius sun, Pisces moon. He's a big old sweetheart. I relate to him very much. I will say, I mean, I feel like Winona was at her peak and just, like, so cute. Very aesthetically pleasing character, but she was almost, like, a little placeholder. Like, I feel like she wasn't... She was kind of underwhelming, too. Like, she could have been more.
Yeah, I feel like your main characters in this film that stand out are Edward and Joyce. Yes. Joyce is a mom, right?
Right.
Those are your two main characters. Those are your standout characters, and I'm okay with that. I'm not upset with it. Like you said, there could have been some better dialogue, but you don't go to this movie for dialogue. I feel like you go to Tim Burton movies.
Well, sometimes, like the Willy Wonka kind of had a lot of funky dialogue.
And it surprises you. And if you don't go for it and it pops out, that's why a movie like Heathers, you know, there's so much to the plot and everything that it doesn't need to have that weird.
Yeah, I feel like Tim Burton gets, I don't want to say gets away with it a lot, but... Because it's so beautiful, because of the cast, because of the score from Danny Elfman, he doesn't need that heavy script with a lot of jabs, with a lot of wit and charm. because you have everything else. And even Ed Wood sometimes, I feel like, isn't as heavy on the talking and the script, because if you know that story, it's a fucking love letter to Ed Wood. And you love it because of what it is. Ed Wood was like the guy that directed the worst movies before the worst movies were made, like Plan 9 from Outer Space. But he had this passion for filmmaking that probably maybe outside of Lloyd Kaufman's never been matched.
Probably not. Yeah.
Yeah. He's just a low budget. I love film. I want to make films. I'm going to make films no matter what. But that's what he was. Ed Wood was just the guy that nothing got in his way. He was going to make films. And it didn't matter if they were good, because they were awful most of the time. You could see his passion. And then Tim Burton made a movie starring Johnny Depp as Ed Wood. And Bela Lugosi, I don't remember who was. It's called Ed Wood.
The one with Bela Lugosi is Plan 9 from Outer Space.
And Ed Wood was in it, who played the original Dracula. And he fell on hard times. He was out of work. He was an alcoholic. That movie is a complete love letter to cinema and passion. But I feel like you give it a pass because it's that.
Oh, I mean, you can see, especially if you are into art, or you just feel like once you start to watch movies and really care about the person who's making it and whatever, I mean, you can see, it's not even the potential, you see their vision, you know?
Did you guys want to rate this?
Let's get into some of the pop culture with the movie. In 2012, on an episode of Family Guy, Lois comes out of her shell, that's the name. Johnny Depp plays Edward Scissorhands. He does a babysitting job.
I remember that one.
Cuts the baby up. An ad for the Cadillac Lycan, an electric car with hands-free driving features, premiered during the Super Bowl and is based on the film. It features Ryder reprising her role as Kim, now mother to Edward's son, Edgar. I've never seen that commercial. And there was a comic book series that takes place decades after the film.
Really?
10 issues and 2 trade paperbacks. And then an extinct lobster-like sea creature called, Cudicella Deppi is named after Depp because of its scissor-like claws.
I'm that.
She's that.
That's like, what I am.
Yeah, she's the Cudicella Deppi, whatever that is. That sounds fish. Like a something you'd get like at a fancy restaurant. And it's like so octopus and shrimp with a wine glaze.
You're in the vegetarian household. I'm sorry, we don't talk about that here.
You're a vegetarian?
Yeah, I don't eat meat.
Asparagus with a mushroom and a wine glaze.
Okay.
Pan-seared with a creme brulee cheese. I don't know.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, that's what she's eating. Now that we've talked about some of the pop culture stuff and the creme brulee cheese, I don't even know if that's a thing. It sounds fancy.
I like it. You made a new dish tonight.
Yeah, I made a new dish. Mm-hmm. Now we can rate it. Who would like, you want to go first and we'll have our guest go last?
So, yeah, we do rate on a scale of 1 to 5. Coming back to this, it's been like probably 15, 20 years since I last saw it. And I would give it a 4 out of 5, running with scissors.
Don't do that. I'm right there with Rod. We watched it at home this week, so I had a 6-year-old watch it with me.
Oh, you did? Okay.
Yeah, this is a kid-friendly movie. There's not, at the end, there's some blood. I mean, there's not really any sex. There's some foul language, but nothing that a kid can't be like, ugh. There's way worse stuff on TV and on the news. So I gave it a 4 out of 5 jealous boyfriends, and Finley gave it a 5 out of 5. She didn't say what, but she said, I said, this is one of the best movies you've ever seen.
Wait, jealous boyfriends, what?
Yeah, because her boyfriend was jealous of Edward, remember?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. That's
what,
just,
it's a theme that you like?
Yeah. Well, I like it's kind of like plays into the movie because
I love it.
I don't feel like Edward's ever like, I'm going to take your girlfriend. He's just kind of there.
What's your rating on him?
I think I'd say a 4 too. It's definitely one of my favorites as far as, like I said, being just like a cozy watch that just feels good, you know? And it makes me feel great. But like I said, it was just, you know, I get a little bit disappointed with the dialogue and everything. And not, I wasn't upset, but, you know, I was trying to really look into it this time and tear it apart. And it was good.
It needs more dialogue.
It's classic. No, just a little bit different, I guess. I don't know. And I think a little more love. It says it's a romance. It's a love story. Like I said, there's familial love.
You know who else likes familial love? Our podcast network, the Pumpkin Fever Podcast Network. So let's hear from them.
You're listening to the Prescribed Films Podcast Network, home to hundreds of hours of free podcast entertainment. The shows on this network all have a common goal, providing you with the best discussions about movies and other forms of entertainment media. The PFPN hopes to fill your earholes with audio joy. Visit our website with links to all the other amazing shows at www.thepfpn.com. Thanks for listening.
So now that we've heard from our podcast network, it's time for the news, and it's December of 1990. And on December 5th, Iraq announces its willingness to speak with the U.S. about resolving the Persian Gulf crisis.
Yeah, I remember this because that whole Desert Storm thing was just insane, and how our society decided to merchandise it. There were trading cards of the Desert Storm, five-star general cards. You had Schwarzkopf and General Patton, I can't think of his name, but
well, it was a movie.
There was Desert Storm. It was kind of weird. I looked that up today. It started August 2nd, 1990, and it could only continue to February 28th of 1991. It just seemed like a much longer conflict than that. I mean, that's only like 6 months.
Well, you have to think, wasn't Saddam Hussein the dictator or whatever he was, of president of Iraq? And he's been, he's dead now, but he lived for years after that, right? They invaded.
Yeah, he did. He died maybe, 10 years ago?
Yeah, they invaded Kuwait.
Rest in peace.
No, not really. He was a
he's a bad person.
He was a bad person. I feel like.
I don't think that's funny.
Yeah.
We'll edit that out. Sorry.
I thought it was funny. Yeah.
The weirdest part about that war is Iraq invades Kuwait, which is our friend because we get our oil from Kuwait. So they're just as bad of people as Saddam Hussein was. Uh-huh. So it's like we only went to war because we were afraid to lose our oil. There was no real, these are the bad guys and these are the bad guys. It was like, hey, you're fucking with our oil supply. And that's one of my notes. Oil, gas went up to $1.60 a gallon because of the Persian Gulf War.
Wow.
Yeah.
It was like America goes, hey, all their friends, they go, hey, you remember WW1, WW2? Your time to help us out here. We want our oil back.
And then on December 14th, a right-to-die case permits Nancy Cruzan to have her feeding tube removed, and she dies 12 days later.
Oh, wow. That's a long time.
Okay. Yeah,
that's a long time to, you think, have your feeding tube out. So I didn't really do any more research into this, but I would imagine she had maybe some kind of cancer or some disorder where she couldn't eat. So she had a feeding tube. She wanted it removed because she was terminal, and finally, a court said, okay, you can, and you can die how you want to die.
Ooh, it's so horrible, though, to actually,
but 12 days.
You're just starting to death, that's all.
It's eating your own body, too.
Oh.
Someone that's worked in healthcare for 25 years now, we will let our animals die peacefully, but people we make suffer so damn much.
Oh, in hospice, it's the worst thing to see ever.
Yeah, so.
Horrible. Yeah, that's awful.
Some more news on December 7th. Actress Jane Fonda and TV mogul tycoon Ted Turner announced their engagement. They wed on December 21st of 1991, but they would later divorce May 22nd of 2001. So they lasted about 10 years.
10 years. I wonder. Well, she was pretty well off too, but he had more money than.
Yeah, he definitely. He was the creator.
TBS.
Oh,
wow. Yeah, TBS, TNT. Is he still alive?
Yeah, as far as I know, he is. He ran WCW wrestling. December 9th, Lech Wałęsa, some dude from Poland. He wins the first direct presidential election in Poland. on December 11th, 13 people die in an 83 vehicle accident in Chattanooga, Tennessee on I-75 because of fog.
Ooh. What?
I bet they didn't see that coming.
No, they did not see that coming. And then on December 20th, the world's first website and server go live at CERN. I don't know if that's CERN or if it stands for something, but the internet went live and dial-up started to the general public, not for like businesses and stuff. And you'd get like low, slowly, like, oh, I can see your leg. Oh, Rod. No. And then this computer crashed and he was upset.
Well, didn't you have to like dial in and...
Yeah.
Yeah, I liked
that. And then somebody would call and you'd be like, Mom, I was trying to look it.
Oh my God.
The baseball score.
Yeah, or somebody, it would cut like your brother off. Would have to come down.
Okay, last piece of news that I had was on December 13th. The South African president, F.W. de Klerk, meets with Nelson Mandela to discuss the end of apartheid.
Okay.
Yeah, very important in the history of the world.
That is important.
Yeah.
What year do you think the Mandela effect started?
Probably 1990.
1990.
maybe, I don't know. It's probably always been a thing. It's just never happened.
About the Mandela effect. You thinking it's always been a thing? Thought it was always around, but it wasn't.
I don't know. You look into that.
Ooh. That's kind of spooky, isn't it?
Yeah, look into that and report back to us.
Yeah.
I'll email you.
Should we get into some music news?
Let's go sport. You got sports or you got music?
I got a little bit of sports. NHL grants conditional membership to Tampa Bay Lightning, and the Lightning would go on to win the Stanley Cup in 2004, 2020, and 2021.
Yeah, the Stanley Cup champion, Tampa Bay Lightning. You know who won the Heisman Trophy that year on December 1st?
I do not know.
Ty Detmer from Brigham Young, and he went on to have no career in the NFL. I mean, I played for the Packers, I think. No, he wasn't very good. And then in the 55th Iron Bowl, Alabama beats Auburn 16-7. That was a barn burner. And then Florida State beats Penn State in the Blockbuster Bowl 24-17. Low scoring games. Hell, now they score like 50 points. That's all I got for sports news. Wasn't a lot going on in sports.
So the baseball Indians agreed to lease a new ballpark in Gateway. They call it Jacobs Field. I don't know. You know a little bit more about baseball than I do.
I think they still play at Jacobs Field, but they're not the Indians anymore. They're the Cleveland Guardians. I have a patient that comes in the office who still has Indian clothes on. He's like, I'm from Cleveland.
They rock.
Yeah, they do, yeah.
Cleveland rocks.
That's where the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is, yeah.
Yeah, speaking of music news, number one in the U.S. was Because I Love You, the Postman song by Stevie B.
Do you know that song?
I know the song.
I know the song, yes.
Stop.
He's like at the piano and he's playing and he's got this freaking awesome frohawk.
Bro,
I remember the video.
You know what? You remember it perfectly. We listened to it. We watched the video a little bit. I turned it off a little premature.
Do you know what the number one in UK was?
We do, and it was very catchy.
Da-na-na-na-na-na. Oh, are you getting claimed if I do this because I'm so good?
Because you're so good? No. No, they will not claim you for being good.
It was Ice Ice Baby by the infamous Vanilla Ice.
Yo, VIP. Let's kick it. Ice Ice Baby.
What was the one that he stole that from?
Queen, Under Pressure.
Under Pressure.
Yeah, that's a better song than all the ones we've listed. And the number one country song?
I had George Strait, I've Come to Expect It From You.
Don't know that one either.
I do.
Very good time. And you know that one too?
Will you sing it?
I love George Strait.
George Strait, but are you going to sing Autumn Once You...
This I Will Not Sing. It's a sad song.
Oh.
Aww. Does it make you... Will it make you weepy?
Maybe a little bit.
I love that.
What else you got in music news? Anything?
The top pop song was from Whitney Houston, I'm Your Baby Tonight.
Oh.
What's that? I don't remember that. We should have played that.
Probably look a lot like Whitney Houston does right now.
Stop.
Yes. What? Who do you feel worse for, Rod or Whitney Houston?
Oh, that's and then, sad.
In movie news.
Oh, that's where I say rest in peace and you don't cut it out.
No, that's I mean, right. Yeah.
Rest
yeah,
in peace, yeah. Whitney.
You better leave the other one in. I'm going to be so upset.
And we'll put a little clip in there after you say that. It goes, the wrong podcast died has no affiliation with Saddam Hussein or his affiliate.
Nothing that is spoken by the guest on this podcast is represented by or no beliefs.
She had no clue who Saddam Hussein was at the beginning.
Unless we can get discounts on our gas, then we'll talk.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. December 9th, the 23rd annual NAACP Image Awards. Coming to America wins Outstanding Motion Picture.
You like that movie?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Love that movie.
Or who's the guy that Eddie Murphy plays? You know that movie?
I think I need to refresh.
He works at a...
You guys
what's
really know
the
that
name
movie?
Of the McDonald's? No? McDowell's. It's not McDonald's. It's McDowell's. Top at the box office in October was A Graveyard Shift. Then in November 4th, Jacob's Ladder. November 11th, Child's Play 2. Very heavy horror in that first, you know, in that area. And then Home Alone. From November 18th till at least January 1st, it was the second highest grossing Thanksgiving weekend movie all time. Biggest pre-holiday fall opening. 12 weekends in a row at number one.
You
a lot of five-day weekends in there, too. Oh, because Christmas. It was a five-day weekend. And January 1st was a five-day weekend. I don't know how they got 5 days off, but...
You ever watch movies like that ever?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah, Home Alone, yeah. It's all right.
Well, yeah, and you can watch with your daughter, too.
Yeah.
I didn't find any famous births, really, at that time. There was a couple deaths. There was, on December 7th, D. Clark, who was a singer of Raindrops. He died at age 52. And then also that day, Joan Bennett, actress of Suspiria, Little Women, and House of Dark Shadows. She died at 80. Yeah, she was one of the teachers.
And then in some TV news, on December 13th, the Sci-Fi Channel begins transmitting on cable. Some of the top shows at that time on NBC was Cheers, 60 Minutes on CBS, Roseanne on ABC, A Different World, and The Cosby Show on NBC, Murphy Brown on CBS, Empty Nest. I love that movie. Or that TV show.
I love all these shows.
America's Funniest Home Videos. And then, of course, Monday Night Football on ABC. And then Golden Girls and Designing Women on NBC.
These are so good. My God. This is Roseanne was, like, truly changed my life. Did you like that growing up?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to go to Ottumwa, Iowa. Well, actually, after this. We'll be there before this comes out. But that's where the... Lanford Lunchbox, you know that?
Oh my God, that's crazy.
The restaurant that's based on is in Ottumwa, Iowa, because Tom Arnold, who was Roseanne's husband, from Ottumwa, Iowa.
He taught for the longest time, probably still does, an acting class at school there or whatever.
Yeah.
That's so funny.
You have any more TV?
That's all I got for the TV.
So I got toys. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was big, of course, in the 90s. Um, 1990, their Party Wagon and the Sewer Play set were the big toys, the ones you had to get for the holidays. And then you had New Kids on the Block action figures. My sister, who was a year younger than me, she had all of them. Go-Go Pup was a battery-operated dog on a leash that was often sold out, that you couldn't get it. The third annual Holiday Barbie came out. But the biggest thing was the Super Nintendo was released November 21st of 1990.
Probably couldn't find that either.
Probably not, no.
You said the first Super Nintendo?
Yeah, the Super. So not Nintendo, the Super Nintendo.
So what did that look like?
It was a top loading.
Yeah, top loading. You didn't slide the cartridge in. It top loaded. Uh-huh. Had like two purple buttons on the front.
Were you a Nintendo or PlayStation?
Well, PlayStation wasn't a thing back then. It was Sega Genesis, right?
Yeah, Sega Genesis before PlayStation.
That's what I meant. When did that...
We never had any of that growing up, but I always had friends that had them, so we'd go to, like, their house. I have a son that's 19, and I told him one day, I was like, go outside. And he's like, well, I gotta play a game. And I was, he's like, didn't you play games? We only played games if it was dark, raining, or snowing. If it was nice out, we were outside.
Oh, I love that.
You only got to go play games if it was after hours, like street lights came on, or you couldn't go outside.
First time I got a video game, it was for my parents. It was the Atari, but it was in 1993. So that's like 20 years after the Atari originally came out.
Wow.
So the cost of living, some average prices for some consumer goods, a car was about $16,000. Annual tuition for a four-year public college, about $3,100. Postage stamp was 32 cents. Pack cigarettes, $2.02.
Wow.
Internet was about $20 a month.
Right?
A pair of jeans was $35. What kind of fucking jeans are these people wearing? Movie ticket was about $14. Monthly cost of cable TV was about $22. A case of beer must have been good beer because it was $14.50. Average cost of a concert ticket was $25. One of the things that hasn't really moved, video game cost about $50.
What?
Yeah, you could get a subscription to a magazine for about $2 a month. Some food, a loaf of bread was about $1. Milk was $2.78. McDonald's hamburger was 89 cents. A Big Mac meal, $3.22.
Oh, good old days.
The average cost of a pizza was about $15.
I got some of the fashion trends. You had the bucket hats.
All these things are coming back right now.
Oh, yeah.
Thick headbands was listed on there, but I didn't really think of anybody who had a thick headband. Slip dresses.
Oh, yes. Cute. Very much.
Baggy jeans.
They're all coming back. All this stuff.
Combat boots, those seem to come back every 10 years. Flannel. One thing that I just recently received one of these, those slap wraps or slap bracelets, the little metal ones, and you hit them on your wrist. I was at the little con of horrors in Council Bluffs. Our friends from Screams from the Basement, Sam and Casey, they gave out these little slap bracelets.
You got any jokes?
I actually did not get any jokes. Sorry. Did you got something?
So my first joke is for Edward Scissorhands, and it's kind of more of a saying. It says, say what you want about Edward Scissorhands, but I think he's a pretty sharp guy. And then this is a Halloween joke. Why didn't the vampire attack Taylor Swift?
Why is that?
Because she has bad blood. They're like dad jokes. I was like, I couldn't find anything inappropriate to go with this. So we want to thank Autumn for being a guest on the show. I hope she had fun.
Thank you. I had so much fun.
Yeah, we might have to have her back someday. I don't know.
We'll see. I miss you guys already.
We ain't even left.
I know.
So before we go, I know we just got back from Halloweenapalooza, but still going on in Michigan is our friend Clint from the I Like It Spooky Horror podcast. That's my other podcast, but we're all friends and family. He's got his haunted house and haunted trail and haunted... I mean, there's so much to do where he's at. He's got Haunting in the Hills in Onsted, Michigan, and that's going on through October 28th, I believe, that last weekend in October. And then the first weekend in November, the 2nd, he's going to show The Toxic Avenger, the original. He's going to have two of the cast from the movie there. He's going to have vendors for the event. I will be there. So if you're in Michigan, if you love trauma, if you can get to Michigan, come to the event. It's all over our socials. That'll be a blast. I mean, it's
That's so cool.
It's
40th anniversary of Toxic Avenger.
Well, yeah, the 40th anniversary of the Toxic Avenger. Two people that are going to be there. A meet and greet with Gary Schneider and Robert Pritchard, who play the two guys in the car that are running people over.
Two bullies.
Yeah, then they're also in the Class of Nukem High, which I love that film. I mean, that film's so much fun. But they're going to be at the screening. They're going to be doing a meet and greet and autographs, I would imagine. So come hang out, buy some cool stuff, watch The Toxic Avenger. Maybe one day it'll be cool enough and we'll get the new Toxic Avenger. I don't know if that's ever going to happen. But
that would be nice. You know,
since we can't get that, come to Michigan and hang out. Watch the old Toxic Avenger.
That sounds so fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you said there's like haunted house.
So he's got Haunting in the Hills. He's got the Train Car of Terror, which is an indoor walkthrough.
So fun.
He's got the Mutant Escape Massacre Hayride. And he's got an After the Flesh indoor walkthrough.
That's so cool.
Yeah. So on October 20th and 27th, You can drive your own vehicle through the Mutant Escape Massacre, which is family night. They're Sunday family night. So it's $30 a car. So however many people you can fit in your car, you can just drive through there. You have like a clown car. But yeah, it's
a Christmas light show for October.
Yeah, but he's going to have some cool guests there. Dead Fred's going to be there. Leah Stalker, I think, is going to go out and do some, you know, some acting and scare people. But yeah, it's, I'm not much for haunted houses, but I think it'd be fun to go through. And Finley asked if we could go through with the lights on. And I said, I'm sure he'll let you.
That's,
I
mean, he's cool.
Got, I don't know how booked the hotel is up there, but he's got a hotel that he's having people stay at. So, I mean, he's turning it into just like this huge go and hang out and have a great time.
That's,
he's going to be the Ted Turner of haunted houses here soon.
So,
well, people love, I mean, it's,
yeah.
So cool.
We threw this in, so you may hear us on one or two episodes say, and on our next episode, and that may not happen because our good friend Autumn was like, I want to talk about Edward Scissorhands. And we're like, okay, well, we got to fit this in somehow because it's,
thank you so
Halloween
much.
And spooky season.
It makes me so happy.
Yeah, so we fit it in there.
You guys are so, fun. I feel like we all fit in great together. So
I feel bad, though, because we had our friend Brett Royer on the show, and we're like, he's our first guest.
Oh.
But that show doesn't come out till November, so sorry about you. Oh,
sorry, yeah. Brett.
I mean, sorry, Brett, you're attractive.
Sorry, hey.
She's,
Brett, you,
yeah, she's nicer and more attractive.
Thank you so much. That's
she
so
doesn't
nice
have chin
you.
Hair like all of us.
That's so nice.
So like and subscribe. Smash that like button
smash
or whatever the
button.
Kids, yeah, whatever the kids are saying these days, because we're gonna have more content, right? I mean, hell, we're almost,
yeah, we're gonna have constant content.
We almost got recorded through the end of the year. If that gets you any idea how far ahead we are and how long you're gonna be stuck with us.
And as they say in the land of spaghetti and meatballs, fino alla prossima volta.
Yeah,
what does that mean?
He won't tell. I know what it means because I looked it up. He either just ordered pasta with extra breadsticks.
Yum.
Or he's got a demon coming to his house later.
No. Or both. What about
or both?
That sounds so good.
What if a demon brought breadsticks?
Oh, okay.
That marks the end of our broadcast day here at The Wrong Podcast Died. Our transmission is powered by a frequency of 800 watts. We will resume our usual programming in 2 weeks. Until then, we bid you good night.